that the spin n plus 1 goes to the first, it's the first spin. So our main object of interest would be the partition function. So one way to calculate the partition function in the 1D IC model is by this method of conservators. So what we get is very interesting calculating it. This is the sum over all the possible configurations of the spins, which are 2m2 to the n. So instead of only considering that, a more interesting model would be if we consider that in a magnetic field, and that will give me another term, which is of the form like this. And we want to calculate the partition function for that method. So what we could do is, because this is the sum of, what we can do first is put this in a more symmetric way. So we could divide over 2 over here and do this other term. And we could, this sum, we could put it as a product over here. So we will have something like this. Which is the multiplication of a lot of exponentials. Now, this could be seen as well as a 2x2 matrix, where this B is this component, and if we take the values, the possible values of the sigma I, which are plus or minus 1, we will have all the products of all the possible values of inside this this matrix. So if we take that, we will have the spin I by the plus 1, and this spin I plus 1 by the plus 1, and so for the other term. So this over here could be seen as we're taking the multiplications of these B matrices until we have the n term, which will be sigma n plus 1, plus this sigma n plus 1 is the sigma 1, because we have a periodic boundary condition. So this over here is like taking the trace. The trace of a matrix. So our partition function only, we only have to calculate the trace of a matrix, which it's only a problem of the diagonalization of this B matrix. And after diagonalizing, we will have something like this. Really, see, the partition function is the one of the eigenvalues to the end plus the other eigenvalue to the end. Okay, so again, we're interested in the partition function in the thermodynamic limit where n goes to infinity. So we see that the dominant term of the partition function when it goes to infinity n, it's the plus one. So what we get is that in the thermodynamic limit, so once we have our partition function, we could start calculating things like the free energy or the correlation functions. So that's what we're going to do now. So say, for example, we want to know whether the correlations are. Okay, so first we want to calculate what is the mean of this PMI, and also we want to calculate what is the mean of this thing. So what we get is we take again 1 over c, the sum of all possible configurations. So we're trying to calculate this thing, but again we wanna do our matrix transfer matrix method. So we know that we can associate all of these things with a 2x2 matrix, and we wanna associate this thing with also a 2x2 matrix. So what we do is we name this over here like. So what we do is add another index to the sum, which will be this prime sim index, and we put a delta function in order to be the same as it was earlier. So what we got in the end is thank you. estimators between the two factors of sigma I and sigma I prime. And so this looks again like a matrix multiplication. What we do is, because this looks like a trace, we use the cyclic property of the trace, and what we got is this. And again, this is a problem of diagonalization, and what we got. That's the value that we got. We see that the value is independent of the position I. This is due to the translation invariance of the problem. And now we're going to calculate the same thing, but with the sigma I, sigma j. And we see that it will be the same idea, only we have to be careful where to put our S matrix. And what we will have is something like this. Can be seen if we put h equals 0 over here and take t going to 0 or beta going to infinity. Okay, so now that we have reviewed how to solve it analytically in 1D, we want to see how the renormalization group could be used to solve this.
So So this part was familiar to everyone, right? It's just with you, right?
Is it there? Did everyone hear this?
I didn't see it.
But is it there?
Okay, so no questions. So initially what we have is our change, our chain which have n spins, and the basic idea of renormalization is to do an iterative procedure to see how is the behavior of our problem at different scales. So what we do is we originally have this, we apply our renormalization procedure, and we will have something like this with n prime spins left. And the way of doing this could vary a lot. So for example, suppose I could start by doing the renormalization procedure only with two spins, or change two spins, which means that our length scale of this, if we have a lattice spacing of A and a lattice spacing here of A prime, what we got is that the ratio between the length scale over here and over here will be something like 2. But if instead we have chosen to do it in steps of 3 spins instead, and 3 spins over here, what we'll have is something like the length scale will have to change like 3. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna take the up spins, and I'm gonna in the partition function I'm gonna integrate it out. So what we would have been left is with n prime spins, which will be half of the original spins that we got. So before doing all of this, we want to see how does this renormalization procedure affects the partition function, the free energy density, and the correlation length. So originally what we have is the lower partition function was a trace over En of the of our original Hamiltonian, and I'm taking over here the dimensionless Hamiltonian, and we want to see how this procedure affects when we are taking the partition function not of n but of the n prime spins left. So what we got is something like this.
What do you mean by tracing a function?
What?
by the Bernoulli function in the trace of exponential length of time?
So you take the energy eigenvalue basis, and you take the trace, and you will have exponent, the sum of the exponent, the possible values of the
energy problem exponent.
So suppose we come in as this case, and you take the trace for these bases. So what you're left is the sum over the possible configurations into the dimension with the dimensionless element. It's the same what we did over there, so sticking the trace over the energy eigenbasis.
The problem that we were considering at the beginning, is it classical or quantum? Is there a quantum mechanical problem or classical?
I think it doesn't matter because sigma z commutes with itself. So, okay. Okay, so we're taking the partition function of our new system, where I put over here the Hamiltonian prime, because this is the Hamiltonian after we have done the renormalization procedure, which it will be in general different from the Hamiltonian that we have over here. So what we can do is, let's say this over here. So the same thing could be said for the free energy, because the free energy depends on the partition function. But what about the free energy density? So the free energy density would be the free energy divided by the number of spins. And we know that the number of spins on our system will change in general after the renormalization procedure. So say we want, how is f related to, so this f is a function of the couplings of the Hamiltonian, of our original Hamiltonian, and we want to know how this relates to the new one. So when we go, look at this. We know that our free energy doesn't change because it depends only on the partition function. So what we got is something like this. And we know that n prime divided by n is this thing, b. That our free energy will be changing like this. And lastly, for the correlation that So this is because this is a landscape. We are changing our problem from an original landscape of A to another one where we have 2A. We have to divide it by this change of landscape from the original one. So that's the reason why it has to change the correlation then.
Okay.
So now that we have done all of this, we can calculate our partition function and do the renormalization procedure. So suppose our dimension is Hamiltonian, is of the form of this. So this is our original partition function. So what we're gonna do is this goes from 1 to n, and we're summing first the odd spins, for example. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna take the odd spins and sum it. So we will be summing first the 1, the 3, the 5, and so on. So after summing this, what we have is something like this. So what we've done is we have some for the odd spins, and we have rescaled our problem so that we are taking the trace over the n prime spins left. And now what we impose is say that this thing over here has to be equal to that this partition function has the same form as the original one, but with another couplings. So what we're saying is that form, only the decouplings will be different. In general, when we do the renormalization procedure, this won't be true because we will have another extra terms which can arise because of this integrated app. But for the case of ICM in 1D, we can actually find the new couplings, and it will have this form only. So after making this equal to this, we have our recursive relation for our renormalized couplings. So it's just a matter of replacing the values of sigma I, which could be plus or minus 1, and sigma I plus 1, also plus minus 1, and after replacing, you have this recursion relation. So the first thing we see over here is that the new couplings H prime and Q prime won't depend on the value of C. So Q prime and H prime would only depend on K and H. What this means is that we know already now that our C was like an energy scale. So this won't affect the physics of our couplings Q prime and H prime. So say that we can actually start with C equals zero. We can set it to zero and see how this evolves. We want to find another recursion relation for the partition function for this one is for n spins for the kh, and this one is for n prime spins in k prime h prime. So we see that this term can come out of the product tutorial in the sum with the n prime times c prime. So taking the log and all this, we can see how the free energy changes. And free energy changes. Okay, so now that we have our recursive relation, we want to see which ones are the critical, the fixed points, which are stable and which ones are unstable. So first, the value of A goes smaller and smaller, so that it will eventually go to the fixed point of K prime equals zero. So our renormalization flow will be something like this. So we see that this point is an unstable fixed point, and this one is an unstable fixed point.
Okay.
So now that we have done it for field zero, now we want to know what about when the magnetic field is not zero. So if we do a little bit of math, we can get these simulations. Sorry, I forgot about mentioning something over here. We can actually see how the correlation that we can find an expression for the correlation length for this case. So we remember that the correlation length was something like this. This relation like this, where p is equal to the time hyperbolic of k, and v prime is time hyperbolic of k prime. And so the only the correlation then will only depend on this coupling. So what we have is something like this. This equation has the solution of the number of which was what we have in the when we do the analytical result. Okay, so now that I've said this, we want to see how what is the renormalization flow for the magnetic field not equal to zero? Okay, so from over there we know that one fixed point is when we have h equal to zero and k equal to zero. And another fixed point which we can see is that if we take k equals to infinity, so from the first part where h was equal to 0, we know that the renormalization flow goes from infinity to 0, so it would be something like this. And from over here, we know that h prime will be bigger than h, because this thing is greater than h. So what we have is that after the renormalization procedure, if we start with a coupling, for example over here, it goes to infinity. The same one. So the renormalization flow is something like this. This would be the plot of the renormalization flow. What we could do is we could linearize our renormalization equations near the fixed points, so to find the critical exponents, but I think that's out of the scope of this lecture. Thanks.
Can you summarize the physics of this plot? What's the physics of this plot? There are lots of things. What's the physics of the fixed points? Why do some things increase, some things decrease?
Okay. So. Okay, so first I'm going to start with the h equals 0 part. So, for example, so when we are taking k equals to infinity, what we are saying is that we are taking the temperature to 0. And when we are taking k equals to 0, what we are saying is we are taking the temperature going to infinity. So say we start with a temperature over here, dc, not t, t1. So what is happening is that after the renormalization procedure, our system will be increasing in temperature, and we will have less spins. So if we do this going on and on, what we eventually will get is we're mapping it into the t equals infinity state, which will be a state where all the possible configurations are possible, and this will mean that our state is our state is going to a disorder system. Okay, so when we have magnetic field which is different from 0, again, what is happening is that k and infinity is saying t equals 0, and k equals 0 is t infinity. So we are plotting, we are going to a state where the temperature is infinity and where we have a fixed magnetic field. Also, this over here is this fixed point is unstable, because when we're taking t equals to 0, the only configuration the configuration that prevails is the one of the ground state. So in the ground state, what we will have is that. Because we have something like this. We're actually preferring the ground state where all the spins are aligned. So either going up or either going down.
states do get a 10. What's the different physics of the different points along the critical line? You said you have a critical line, so if you look at a piece of material that is in one, that is in that line, how do you tell where you are?
In the end, you will have a mean magnetic field.
So what does the state look like?
I'm actually quite not so sure. I think that you will have parts that are parallel to the magnetic field, and it won't look so disordered as in the case of H equals 0.
Sorry, H equals 0?
So, in the case H equals 0, what we have is a disordered state, where the spins can be either up or down. And I think that if we go along the line, we will have sections of the state which has a main magnetic field pointing in the same direction as H.
Yes, let me say it. So, what this means is that if I look at a piece of material and then I start zooming out and coarse graining, right, my coupling between the spins is going to zero. Right? So that means that the spins are becoming uncorrelated. But the magnetic field is not going to zero.
Yes.
So at the end, the line is a line where everything is uncorrelated. So there are no correlations, right? They are all as if they were independent islands. But when H is zero, the islands can be up or down with equal probability. But when H is not zero, they are distributed up or down with both into the H and into the minus H. So you will see a bunch of uncorrelated islands that have bigger probability of being up if H is positive, bigger probability of being H if H is negative. Right? So you will, as you zoom out, you will see all red or all blue because they are just uncorrelated, and depending on the sign of H, you will just, everyone will be roughly up or roughly down. Right? Depends on how big H is. But the point is that it's uncorrelated, right? You see that things become uncorrelated as they choose. Okay, yeah, it's good. I think, yeah, with more time it would be nice to comment better on the connection between the first part of the exact solution and how we would see the RG here. But I think, as an advertiser, it's okay. People can see the book. This is in this book of normalization, this part here.
Yeah.
Krasnick, if they want.
So, any question?
I
have a question about the flow from H equals 0. These arrows that goes away from H equals 0, I don't understand how this is possible. Because if you have a small H, I can see this section. You have the line of H equals 0 going from K to infinity to 0,
uh-huh.
And then there is a H equals 0 going to some H, plus or minus, and going to K equals 0, right? The other arrows.
This one or this?
This one from here?
This one.
Down. Or up. The other lines besides this one.
The curved ones.
The curved ones.
Okay, this one.
Yes.
Okay.
I don't understand these curved ones. H equals 0, this term log cancels, and then you keep at H.
Oh yeah, if it's in H equals 0, yeah.
So this means near 0, this arrows.
Yeah, it means near 0.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, very good. I'll make a few comments on the very end.